in the course of the 18th and 19th centuries, evolved the idea that the universe doesn't have a heart at all, that it is essentially stupid, and that we, sensitive, intelligent beings capable of love and all sorts of feelings, are an accident. A really deplorable accident. But what a monstrous system in which the tender, sensitive nervous systems that we are could appear in a world that consists principally of rock and fire. That is an impersonal, vast, gyrating nonsense which has no consideration for us men whatsoever. Now, why did such an idea possess the Western world? Why could it be that in the 19th century, Freud could talk about the basic energies of the psyche as libido and compare them to the blind forces of brute emotions? You know? Think of that language. At the same time, Ernst Haeckel and T.H. Huxley and so on were thinking about the world as the manifestation of energy. Say Henri Bergson with the idea of the élan vital. What was the nature of this energy which manifested everything? Essentially, it was something like electricity. Now, electricity, it does wonderful things for us. But essentially, electricity is rather dumb. You switch it on and switch it off. Supposing I could just switch you on and switch you off, you see? But just like that, say, please don't bother me anymore. Psst. And you'd vanish. But that's the name. You see, they thought of the world as having, as being just a surge of like this, you see, but completely stupid. Only after they, how on earth they ever got intelligence out of this is a miracle, but they did, by explaining that if you gave it enough time, it would eventually become intelligent. Well, that's the most nonsensical idea anybody ever thought of. That if just time, you see, would make things more complicated. Now, I want you to, this is the thing that is difficult today, because that idea of the mechanical universe that is essentially dead is a very persuasive one. And most intelligent people today who are products of the college and that particular system of propaganda and indoctrination really feel that this is the case. That they are strangers in an alien world. And that when you die, it'll just be like you were a caterpillar that was squashed. And that will be that. That you're, in other words, an interlude of consciousness between eternal darknesses. And that's all there is. It doesn't mean anything. It is just that. And not much of that, anyway. Not much of a that. Now, what is important is to understand that this is a myth.
We are fundamentally consciousness. Okay? And a metaphor for that is a spiritual being. We are consciousness. And another metaphor for that would be a soul. Okay? There's lots of metaphors for describing that, but we are consciousness. And as consciousness, you know, that's our fundamental state. That's what's real about us. This physical thing is a schoolhouse, a game we're in to have interactions, to make choices so that we can grow. So where does science come into this? Science comes into this because when you look at reality as a virtual reality, a virtual digital reality, and you look at the experiences that you have in a larger consciousness system, and you look at science with its inability to understand why C is a constant and why particles are probability distributions, and suddenly you see this one overarching set of ideas, and you know, bing, 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 they all drop down. You know, everything gets explained under this one arching, overarching set of ideas. And one of the things that gets explained is, you know, quantum mechanics and relativity. Another thing is that you are a spiritual being, and that you are one with the larger consciousness. You're netted with all other life, you know, that exists. And as consciousness, you can explore consciousness. Your piece of consciousness, that gives you the, you know, that's the doorway. Your consciousness is your doorway to the larger reality, because you're a piece of the larger thing. So yes, you've always been a spiritual being. So is everybody else. Most people don't know it. Most people are consumed with their trials and tribulations in this reality. And as well, they probably should be. That's where they're supposed to learn. They're supposed to grow up. But it's not until you grow up to a certain point where you really become aware that you are primarily spirit, consciousness, soul. That's the fundamental thing that this is not. And of course, you know, what was Buddha trying to explain to everybody? That spirit, soul, consciousness was the fundamental thing, and this was not. That we're all growing toward love, so suddenly metaphysics falls out of it as well.
Now, what is there when the reactive entity is no longer operating? Who are you if you are not the reactive entity, the me, that needs its problems and its difficulties and its enemies? Because if it doesn't have them, it can't react anymore. It doesn't know itself anymore. What happens if the reactive me doesn't operate anymore? Who are you? Now, if I continue to speak, this is dangerous because language is form. I'm pointing to the formless essence of who you are. So I will continue to speak, but we need to know now, whatever I say now is form, it only points, it's not it. Any word that I use is not it, it's only a pointer beyond itself. So who are you when the form identity, the me, is no longer operating, and it stops when you enter the state of yes? One could say there's suddenly a sense of spaciousness. There's a sense of space in which things happen. So you are aware suddenly not only of what happens, you're aware of a spaciousness, and this is only a pointer, a field of spaciousness in which it happens. One could almost say a field of peace that is around events, people, whatever it may be, that field is there. That's the essence of who you are beyond form. That's also the deepest meaning of what we call the now, the present moment. Because ultimately, at the deepest level, that is what the now is. So at the deepest level, you are the now, this moment in which it all happens.